country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night.
And the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them.
And they were so afraid that the angel said unto them,
Fear not, for behold, I bring you tidings of great joy, which will be to all people.
For unto you is born this day of the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. You will find your baby wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger.
And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of heavenly hosts praising God and saying,
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace and goodwill toward men.
Let's bow in prayer. Father, one of the most familiar stories, whether people know about the Bible or not. Around the world, we tell the story. Father, I pray that our hearts have a new openness to the authority of your word this year, 2019 of Christmas. For some of us, I know for me, I have literally heard that story since as long as I can remember. Over 60 times, years, I've gone through a Christmas season. But Father, each one is new and different because of the circumstances surrounding the year we have just encountered, endured, or been blessed with. I pray that our hearts are all open today to the truth of this story. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. When's the last time you held a newborn baby? I don't mean one that's been all cleaned up after a couple weeks and has that little knit cap on. I mean a newborn. For some of you, maybe it's been recently. For some of us, maybe it's been quite a while. Maybe for some of you, never. There is something unique about being one of the first to be invited, come and hold the newborn baby. For emotional reasons and physical reasons and even cultural reasons, birth is, by its very nature, one of the most personal and intimate moments in human life. And therefore, it is not appropriate to want to be part of that just because you're curious. I think I'll show up in the hospital today and watch a couple births. Nobody does that. So making the invitation list to be among the first to come and hold the newborn. Those invitations aren't handed out willy-nilly. You have to be on a very special list. Even being a close relative or friend doesn't guarantee that you get invited to do that. I had the privilege 3 times, first as a young father, but it wasn't so much an invitation as it was a presumed expectation. So I was there. Then humbly, I will say this, many years later, obviously, we weren't present at their birth, but Linda and I were invited 6 times. Come and be the first to hold the newborn as grandparents. This idea of invitation is told to us in the story of Jesus, the Messiah of the world, come to this world, born into the world as each of us were, and is told to us through the story of an invitation. The story is told to us by Dr. Luke, the 3rd gospel writer. We've heard part of the story, but let me tell you how the story began, as if you don't know this part. In those days, a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered, yes, taxed. And this is the first registration or taxing when Quirinius was governor of Syria. And all went up to be registered, each to his own town. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, specifically from the town of Nazareth, to Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be registered with Mary, his betrothed, who was with child. And while they were there, the time came for her to give birth. and she gave birth to her firstborn son, wrapped him in swaddling clothes, laid him in a manger because there was no place for them in the inn. I want you to notice the huge contrast going on here. Let me paraphrase. A young couple is forced by the federal government to make a trip to their specific local ancestral IRS station. They arrive at their designated location just as the young woman named Mary goes into labor. And in what appears to be a rather emergency and quick birth situation, she gives birth to a baby, a boy, and carefully wraps him up like all newborns were wrapped. And circumstances were so unexpected and hurried and humbled that they took the baby and laid him in a feed box for animals because there was no other place available. We've heard the story so often that the strangeness of what Luke describes is often lost on us. But think of the contrast. First, you have all these majestic words, Caesar Augustus, governor, city of David, lineage, registering. And then there's this contrasting whiplash in the story to kind of a very simple, humble, human interest story, almost pitiful. A sudden humble birth and a baby placed in a feed box for animals. Who's going to make it to this first to see the infant invitation list? Who gets invited to this see the baby first? It is an incredible story. If you didn't know the rest of the story, you would be amazed, but you all do, so still be amazed. Because I want, let every heart prepare him a room. Here's the big idea today. Because of the birth of the Messiah, it brings salvation to our human souls. It is literally the most significant and joyous birth in human history. But realizing who intentionally made that first invitation list is what points us in a very personal way in 2019 to our own hope and purpose. So listen to the story with new ears. Listen to it with a new mind. In the same region, there were shepherds out in the field keeping watch over their flocks by night. These shepherds are literally among the most common, ordinary, simple, blue-collar people of their day. They are literally the very definition of people who are minding their own business. And the business they are minding is called sheep, so they're called shepherds. But they're going to make this list. I'm just telling you. And by the way, since it is literally the parents who are in complete control of the list of who gets invited to the first seeing and viewing of the baby, I need to remind you that the baby born in this story is not just the son of Mary. The baby born in this story is the son of God. So God has every right and expectation and is appropriately in charge of inviting whoever he wants to the birth of his son. So let's review the familiar story and find out what this has to do with us. So we already have seen that there's a group of shepherds minding their own business. And there's a humble couple having just given birth in a very private and personal moment. They literally, these two groups, have no prior connection with each other. Nothing connects them. They're not related. They're not work partners. They're not even from the same region. I'm guessing they had different accents, y'all. North, south, it happens here. They've never even met. So how do you get these shepherds, minding their own business, over to this place where a baby is laying in a feed box? Past experience tells me, as I read the Bible, that God has a variety of ways of getting a message to people to move them someplace. Sometimes it's in a dream. Abraham, Jacob, Joseph, Pharaoh, Daniel, he moved them with a dream. They woke up and go, wow, that's something I need to listen to. Sometimes in the Old Testament, lots of times in the Old Testament, there was a group of God speakers called prophets, and they began everything they said with, thus saith the Lord, get moving. So they'd move people that way. But the shepherds don't get a dream. And the shepherds don't get some wizened old prophet wandering in going, thus saith the Lord. Nope. Here's what they get for an invitation. Instead, an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were filled with great fear. For years, we've been dressing our kids in bathrobes, giving them these fake staffs, And it's been cute. But it has dulled us to the reality of literally what is happening. The other night, Linda and I are watching, we're old people, so when we watch something on TV, we each have a blanket. I'm just telling you, that's the way it works in our house. And we're sitting there, and sometimes we're playing games on our phone, you know, or something while we're watching, and it's one of these intense cop shows, and it's the music is building, and all of a sudden there's this, huh! And we both literally go, huh! That's what happened here! You know, we've got the angels, usually in our pageants, the little shepherds are, you know, pretending. This is a really startling thing. And of course, as we mentioned 2 weeks ago when we talked about Mary being visited by the angel, God gives all the angels a standard opening line. It isn't, here's the message, it's don't settle. Don't be afraid. Fear not. Behold, I'm bringing you good news of great joy that'll be for all people. To you, very specifically, to you, this day is born in the city of David. And notice the three words that are used. A Savior, he is Christ, he is the Lord. And suddenly there was with that one angel, a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God, saying, glory to God in the highest and on earth, peace among those with whom he's pleased. Notice the specific location is given to them. The city of David. Now, Luke tells us in his gospel it's called Bethlehem, but that's probably not what the shepherds needed to hear. Everybody knew where the city of David was. We lived in Kansas for a while. It was our first church. There's a town in Kansas called Abilene. If you live in Kansas, this is what you know about Abilene. It is the birthplace of President Dwight D. Eisenhower. So it's just Abilene, we just know that. If you're from North Dakota, and I mentioned the famous city of Strasburg, North Dakota, does anybody know which famous person was born there? Lawrence Welk, a one and a two. Most importantly, it was important for them to be directed to the city of King David. 900 years earlier, David was born in the same area. And most importantly, this baby is given three very important descriptive titles. And remember, they're given to a group of people who haven't gone to school. They're largely uneducated. Maybe a couple years of synagogue school when they were little kids. He's given three names. The first is Savior. It means rescuer, an odd title to give to a baby who is helplessly laying in a feed box. The second one is Christ. It is the word for anointed one, anointing. In the Old Testament, when a prophet or a priest or a king was set apart by God to be a special servant of God, they were literally anointed. Oil was poured on their heads. Reminded them that they were set aside. And the third title given to this baby is Lord, Kurios. It means the master over others, and especially the master over your oppressors, which in this time in Judea happened to be the Romans, who had their boot on the neck of the people, extracting as many taxes as they could out of them. It was a miserable time to be a blue-collar worker minding your own business. These shepherds didn't come from much schooling, but even they knew that it had been promised from years ago that God, if he's up there somewhere, is going to send to us a Savior, a Messiah, a Christ, someone to help us. Luke 2:12, this will be a sign to you. Specifically, shepherds, we want you to go see this. This is the sign you're looking for. You'll find a baby wrapped up in swaddling clothes lying in a manger. This is a very personal note. The word you there is not just y'all, it is you specifically, you shepherds tonight, on this night, this is for you. And although other babies may have been born in Bethlehem that night, only one of them is going to be so recently born that it's wrapped up in swaddling clothes and lying in a feed box. Just a note here about swaddling clothes. I've seen it, maybe I've even said it, maybe I've even preached it, that some people like to turn the whole swaddling clothes into a foreshadowing of Jesus' burial. But not once is Jesus said to be wrapped in swaddling clothes when he died. He's wrapped in a plain linen cloth. Swaddling clothes is simply a measure, a reminder that the baby is so brand new, that these caring parents did what every caring parent does, which is wrap up the baby real tight. That's what they did to kind of mimic the warmth and closeness of the womb, and then swaddle that baby. They even do that today now, more so than they used to years ago. Am I right, Denise? You work in that all the time. We wrap them up tight. Bottom line is, these are parents who desperately love this little baby. Now, after this specific angelic invitation, you would expect the angels to simply fade back into the mist, but they're not fading back into the mist. Instead, the exact opposite happens. Boom! A bunch of angels show up. You think they were surprised before, now they're really surprised. And suddenly there was with the angels a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom he's pleased." They're called here a multitude. The Greek word is plethoros, from which we get our word plethora, or multitude, or bunch. And in the Bible, even once it's used as a company, a great company of soldiers. And notice that they're saying this. They're not necessarily, I'm sorry, Linda. They're not singing this. They're saying this. We always think that songs are the most powerful way to convey some things, and that's sometimes true. But can you imagine the impact it would be to hear a powerful angelic army of people speaking in perfect unison, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom he's pleased. Glory to God." Let us do that together. Just glory to God in the highest. Three times, louder every time. I know you're used to sitting there quiet listening to me, but come on. Let's make this interactive sermon. We're going to do glory to God in the highest three times. Ready? Glory to God. Louder. Glory to God. Louder. Glory to God in the highest. That gets your attention, doesn't it? All of a sudden, we're listening. Shepherds are familiar with Bethlehem. Scholars suggest that Bethlehem had a population of about 300 to 500 people. Not a very big little town. Shepherds probably knew every nook and cranny of this town. It was their town. They knew where every animal feed box is located. So they don't have to bother looking around in hotels or inns or fancy homes. And we know that they're going to do a careful search, because the next words say, and they went and found. They use the word found baby Jesus. And I imagine it went something like this in a loud whisper. Hey guys, over here, I found him. Let's pause here for a moment. What are these shepherds doing here? How did they score a front row seat to be invited to be the first to see not just a baby, that'd be a big deal, but to see the Christ, the Messiah, the Savior? This is the arrival of the Creator onto the planet he created and with the people he created. And the shepherds are invited to look. It would be wrong to call these shepherds nobodies. I think I have done that for years. I've given the impression that they're just nobodies. It's better to call them anybodies. If this story were written today, it might go something like this. And nearby, there were factory workers getting off a night shift, smoking together in the parking lot, and an angel of the Lord came. Or maybe nearby, there were truck drivers fueling up their rigs at a truck stop, and an angel of the Lord appeared. Or nearby there were sleepless parents wandering the dark house, tearfully praying for a wayward child, and an angel of the Lord appeared. Not just nobodies, anybodies. When God visited the planet, he invited not just nobodies, he invited anybodies. The shepherds being included sets the stage for Jesus' ministry 30 years later. And who would make that invitation list to come and stand around Jesus as he spoke? Late in Jesus' ministry, lots of people are begging for his attention. Lots of people want to get healed, want the miracle. Some people just want to hang around him and debate with him. The disciples just want more of him. In the middle of all of this, in Matthew chapter 19, we have this story of some moms bringing their kids to Jesus and saying, "Jesus, you got time to bless my child?" You know how moms are with their kids. "Would you bless my child?" And the disciples go, "Come on, shoo, get away here. And Jesus says, no. They make the invitation list. Let them come in. In John chapter 4, Jesus is resting by a watering well in a foreign country. His disciples went into town to get food, and along comes a woman from that country. We only know her as the Samaritan woman. And they start having this conversation about living water. So here's a picture. This is a Jewish rabbi and a woman who was burned through 5 marriages. And they have this conversation together. And through this conversation, she finds the truth and the transformation of forgiveness and hope. She made the invitation list. But Jesus not only has time for the down and outers, he has time for the up and outers. In John chapter 3, there was a high, powerful man named Nicodemus who snuck to see Jesus at night. And even with all of his knowledge and all of his position and all of his education, he felt lost and empty in his soul. And Jesus has a conversation with him and says, listen, Nicodemus, you've got to be born spiritually, born again. Because God so loved this world that he gave his one and only son that anybody's who believe in him will not perish, but they get to have life eternal. Nicodemus made the invitation list. Jesus didn't come into the world for nobody's. He came into the world for anybody's. I know the invitation seems a little wide right now, but keep in mind, there will be people in heaven, according to Revelation 5, from every tribe and tongue and language and people. And that's not just a cultural description. That's an anybody's can be transformed by the power of Jesus Christ description. There's a certain word to describe this kind of risky invitation, inviting people to something so very personal. Are you ready for the word? We have an English word for it. It's called grace. Getting something you don't deserve or haven't earned. Even people who've lost their way, who've wandered away from God, are given an invitation. Let me take you to the last book of the Bible. Many of us have repeated this verse from the time we were memorizing verses when we were in kindergarten. Revelation 3:20, behold, Jesus says, I stand at the door and I knock. And if anyone opens the door, I will come in and eat with him and he with me. And we often record and repeat that verse to people during an evangelism process where we're trying to convince them to believe in Jesus Christ. But that's not who the verse is written to. The verse is written to believers in a church. The town is called Laodicea in what is modern-day Turkey. And this whole church has lost its way. We're reminded that they are materially rich, but they are spiritually bankrupt. They're arrogant. They're distracted with their own selfishness. They're even called lukewarm in their faith. So listen to the whole invitation, not just verse 20. In verse 19, it begins, those whom I love, Jesus says, I reprove and discipline, so be zealous and repent. See, he's talking to believers. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I'll come into him and eat with him and he with me. And he who conquers, I'll grant him to sit with me on my throne as I also conquered and sat down with my Father on his throne. Here are these embarrassingly backslidden, far from God believers making the list of God's invitation. Come, see not the baby, but see the Jesus again. See the Christ, the Messiah, the hope, the Lord. Jesus is knocking on the door of the hearts of church folk. Like you and me. Will you submit? Will you let me in? The Christmas story teaches us that Jesus does not just invite us to invite him to come into our house. Let me read you something even more abrupt. Jesus invites himself over. That puts a whole new twist on this. He knows that what we need most at Christmas, we need Jesus' presence and truth and lordship, not just in our lives, but in the core of our souls. Do any of these anybody stories touch your heart today? It does mine, even as I prepared the sermon this week. For some of you here today, these stories might be a new realization that for the first time in 2018, it's making sense. I want to believe in Jesus. He came and was born and lived and died and rose for me personally. He's stirring my heart. I want to respond to that. I want his lordship. His cradle led to a cross. And I realize this year it's for me. For others of us, as we hear this, it might be the story of a return, a knock at the door. Maybe we've gotten distracted and we've pushed Jesus out, and we need to invite him back in. Commentator Jeffrey Mannin suggests that there are two appropriate Christmas prayers. I'm going to repeat those to you today. I love this, and I used it in my life, and I'm going to use it the next 2 days too. The first prayer comes to us because God made sure that these anybodies, these shepherds, got an invitation. And here comes the prayer. It's pretty simple. It's just three words. Come on in. You say it to Jesus. Come on, come on in. Let's not kid ourselves. That's a pretty simple prayer, but it's very difficult to do. Think about when someone knocks on your physical door or rings your doorbell at your house. If you are like me, and I think many of you are, on your way to answer the door, you're going, I'm going to throw that behind the couch, and I'm going to push this away, and I'm going to straighten up this, and I'm going to make this door ready to come on in. Jesus didn't come into the world to catch or embarrass us. He came to seek and to save those who have a mess going on behind that door. Maybe we shut that door to him a long time ago. Maybe something happened to us that made us bitter. I can't believe God would let that happen to me. And so we've kind of pushed him away. Maybe we've just got distracted with our own successes. And we don't have a place for him anymore. A proper submissive believing response is not, just a minute, I'll be right there, as we madly try to clean up stuff before we open the door. The proper response is, come on in. I need your help. I've made a mess of this thing. I believe Jesus died to help clean up this mess. But there's a second prayer that we should pray. Not because of the shepherds, but rather because of how the shepherds went into the world at the end of the story. For the last 100 years, we've had a phrase in America called keeping up with the Joneses. You know what it means. It means simply that we compare ourselves when we find our worth. If we don't say it outwardly, but if we can have more than other people, we feel like we're worth a little more than they are. So we're always trying to keep up with the Joneses around us. In our American culture, the more we have that others don't, the more superior we feel. None of us born in this room this morning, none of us have ever known a time in American history when that wasn't true. It has always been true for all of us. We may not have all bought into it, but we know it's true. In the first century, Roman occupied Judea, there was the same thing. It was called philotima. The Greek word means lovers of status. It was a thing. People of that time, when politics in Rome were everything, were desperate to matter. Based on their social status and their name and position, people would plot their entire lives. Who should I marry? What should I do? Who should I invite over? Just so they could raise their status because they loved status. Philotima. Think of the birth of Christ, though. His parents were from Nazareth, a nondescript city in the north of Galilee, a place from which it says in the book of John, nothing good ever comes from there. His earthly parents were not just anybody's, they were nobodies. They were peasants about whom there were probably whispers and rumors about their betrothal and she getting pregnant. And you know, you hear about that? The circumstances of Jesus' birth was such that it included a feed box and shepherds. If you are looking in this story for philotima, for status, not here, not here. Shepherds answered the invitation and they found someone in a more pitiful state than even they were. Paul would later remind Christian believers in the Roman colony of Philippi, don't you do it. Don't you get on this merry-go-round of philotima, of keeping up with the Joneses. He said, in fact, I want you, when you meet together as a church, Philippians chapter 2, make this your common mind. Have this mind about you, which is the same as Jesus Christ, who though he was in the form of God, he didn't count equality with God, a status thing to be grasped. He emptied himself. He took on the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of man. Jesus purposely made himself anti-philotima, an anti-statuser, so that anybody could see that the world system, that keeping up with the Kardashians or keeping up with the Joneses is a fool's errand. No hope. Jesus would turn the whole system on its ear when in Mark chapter 10, he calls to his disciples, said, come here. You guys know that those who are considered rulers in the Gentiles lord it over them. Their great ones exercise authority over them. But it's not going to be that way with you in my kingdom. Greatness does not equal status. Greatness equals service. Whoever would be great among you must be your servant. The greatest one is not the one with the most followers on Twitter. It's not the one with the most friends on Facebook. Even the Son of Man didn't come to be served, but to serve and to give up his very life as a ransom for sinners. So here comes the second prayer. I know you thought I forgot. I didn't. The first prayer has come on, and the second prayer is, Lord, send me. Send me. I want to serve. When the shepherds had seen, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child. So let's review. Jesus came into such humble beginnings that even the very first invited guests were among the lowest status of people on the earth. But wait, it gets worse or better. Jesus would grow up and he would eat with sinners and tax collectors and harlots, people even of lower status than shepherds. But wait, it gets worse or better. Jesus would actually, when he was the rabbi and teacher, he would kneel in front of his own disciples and wash their feet. But wait, it gets worse or better. Jesus, our sinless, perfect Savior, would actually willingly and innocently die on a cross of Roman execution, taking our sins upon himself so we might have purpose and eternal life and find our greatest status in serving his causes. So Perry wants to pray this Christmas, Lord, send me. I want in on some of that. I know you're probably thinking, Pastor Perry, you know, I was hoping at the end of the sermon it would kind of get a little soft and feely, touchy. It's starting to feel a little heavy in here. I get that. And if we're going to make it all about submission and service, that's really what Christmas is going to start feeling like. Christmas is really not just feelings of warmth and tenderness. It's feelings of submission and service. I mentioned this to you a couple weeks ago, maybe last week, I don't remember, about price tags. According to Quora.com, quote, it is considered rude to leave a price tag on a gift that you give someone because you don't want the receiver to feel bad about how much you paid, or if you're the giver, you don't want to feel guilty about not paying more. In fact, we can get gift receipts at the store. We did that just the other day, so that people can't even tell. They can take our stuff back, and nobody's the wiser. We even in our house have a little bottle of something that smells like orange. It's called Goo Gone, and we can erase any sticky leftover of a price tag. But we as Christ followers are commanded by our Lord never to remove, never to forget, never to ignore the price tag of salvation. Keep it out there. In fact, once a month, we bring it out. We call it communion. We want people to remember the price tag so that it motivates us to say continually, I'm all in on this. So always leave the price tag of the cross on at Christmas because it keeps us from becoming cold towards the truth about Jesus. Leave the price tag on there. A couple of applications. I've already started this myself, so if you find this helpful, that's great. Pray the two prayers at least once each day leading up to Christmas. The prayer, come on in. I repent of who I am. I want you to come on in. And Lord, send me. I want in on some of this. Send me. It was a little Bible chorus, a little ditty that I grew up singing in my kindergarten back in the Midwest. I found out this week it was written over 100 years ago by a pastor named Harry Dudley Clark. I'll get to the second application. Don't get concerned. This man had been orphaned as a young boy in Wales. He ran away from the orphanage. He joined the British Merchant Marines. He came to know Christ as a young man, moved to Canada, later to America, and began attending a brand new college called Moody Bible Institute. He became a pastor. He wrote this little ditty, this little chorus, after reading a verse in Ephesians 3:17 that says, that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith. And the little song goes like this. Into my heart, come into my heart, Lord Jesus. Come in today, come in to stay. Come into my heart, Lord Jesus. Come on in. There's a second verse. It goes like this. Out of my heart, shine out of my heart, Lord Jesus. Shine out today, shine out always. Shine out of my heart, Lord Jesus. Send me. Second application. How about if you find some God-glorifying action and sacrifice that reminds you of the true price tag of Christmas? If I haven't sacrificed something personally, and I'm not talking just about money and just about resources, that can be one of them, but I'm talking about truly giving part of yourself to someone. Sometimes it's a family member. Sometimes it's a friend. Sometimes it's an unknown stranger. Send me. I want to do that. I'm going to ask you to stand as we sing together a very familiar song. Hark, or listen to what the herald angels are singing. By herald, it means those who are talking and speaking. I want this to be kind of our closing prayer. I know we normally don't use a carol like this for a closing prayer, but glory to the newborn King. Let's kind of join that chanting chorus by singing a song and saying, we want this to be our message too. Hark the herald angels sing.